Today we're turning away from our work with derivatives to begin studying a new concept, integrals. If you'll remember from a previous video in this series, the derivative of a function at a point is the function's rate of change at that point. In other words, the derivative equation models where and how fast the original function is increasing or decreasing. In contrast, the integral of a function models the area underneath the graph of a function, and it's calculated opposite of the way we calculated derivatives, which is why an integral is also called an antiderivative. Instead of looking for the derivative of a function as we did before, we'll be looking for the function we would have differentiated to arrive at our current function. Think about it this way. From what we know about derivatives, we can see that the derivative of f of x is g of x, and that the derivative of g of x is h of x. Previously, we were always given g of x and only asked to calculate the derivative, and we would have done so and found h of x. No problem. With integrals, we'll still be provided with g of x, but this time, we'll be asked to calculate f of x, its antiderivative. Basically, we're asking ourselves, what function would I have had to differentiate to get g of x? We don't know how to do that yet, but we're going to learn right now. There are two ways to calculate an antiderivative and find the area underneath the curve. Estimate the area using basic geometric area calculations, or find the exact area using integrals. If you're taking a standard introductory calculus class, you'll probably learn how to take an area estimation using Riemann sums, trapezoidal rule, or Simpson's approximation. All of these methods are variations on the same theme. They use rectangles or trapezoids to follow the rough outline of the curve and reduce the area calculation down to basic geometric formulas. As you can imagine, the more rectangles or trapezoids you can use, the more accurate your area estimation can be. If you imagine that you start using a larger and larger number of rectangles or trapezoids, until eventually you use an infinite number, this is the point at which you're making an exact area calculation. Using this infinite rectangle method to calculate area is similar to using the definition of the derivative to find the rate of change of a function. Both methods will get you the right answer, but they're both basic and tedious. In the same way that we learned better tools to calculate derivatives, like product, quotient, and chain rule, we'll learn better ways to calculate integrals. Let's start with basic integral notation. Take this basic polynomial function as an example. To take its antiderivative, we'll wrap it inside an integral and a dx. The integral symbol basically says, take the integral of this function, and the dx says, with respect to x. Think about both pieces of notation as a set. They always have to be together when we're taking antiderivatives. The integral symbol starts it, and the dx finishes it. They're like bookends that tell us to take the integral of what comes in between them. In the same way that you're able to take the derivative of a polynomial function by paying attention to one term at a time, we can take this function's antiderivative by paying attention to one term at a time. To simplify, we'll separate each term into its own integral. When we deal with integrals, we can pull constants out in front of the integral symbol to further simplify the integration. Now all we need to do is the opposite of what we've done in the past with derivatives. Let's focus in on x cubed for a second. To take the derivative of x cubed, we'd bring the 3 down in front and then subtract 1 from the exponent to get a result of 3x squared. Remember that we want to reverse this process in order to take the integral. Well, let's do that. Instead of subtracting 1 from the exponent, we'll add 1. Then, instead of multiplying the coefficient by the exponent, we'll divide the coefficient by the exponent. As you can see, we get an integral of 1/4 x to the 4. Did we really do that right? Well, we can always check ourselves by taking the derivative of our answer. The derivative of 1/4 x to the 4th is x cubed, our original term, so we know we took the integral correctly. We can follow this pattern with the rest of the terms in our polynomial function. We'll always add 1 to the exponent, then divide the coefficient by the new exponent. Now is a good time to say a quick word about constants. Remember how constants would disappear when we took their derivatives? Well, imagine what will happen if we're starting with g prime of x and trying to find g of x, the antiderivative. How would we ever know that the plus 3 was part of the original function? We wouldn't, nor would we know the value of the constant, assuming there even was one. The way that we account for this is by adding the constant of integration to the antiderivative that we calculate. We use a generic plus c to denote it. Remember that the constant of integration must always be added to your integral function when you're dealing with indefinite integrals. Let's return to the integral we were looking at before and give our real final answer by adding the constant of integration to the end of our integrated function. Next time, we'll start talking about some techniques we can use to solve more complicated integrals. I'll see you then. Click on a video for a more in-depth look at the topics covered. Review this video by clicking the links on the right, and subscribe to be notified of future videos.